Tonight, welcome to the fifth advisory committee meeting of the East-West Passenger Rail Study and our first virtual meeting. Very exciting to have you here and appreciate you taking the time this afternoon. I know things have changed since we last met, so we are hoping to have a very productive meeting, but we will have to go through some rules and regs to make it work very efficiently. But before we jump in, I'm going to ask Secretary Pollack to open the meeting and welcome everyone and give us some thoughts on the project.
Thank you, Nancy, and thank you to all the advisory committee members who made the time to join us this afternoon. I really appreciate all the work that you've done, and I apologize that we've had an extended period of radio silence, but I suspect all of us kept ourselves quite busy and hopefully quite safe during this interregnum. So I just thought I would take a few minutes at the outset of the meeting before turning it back over to Nancy and the great staff and consultants from the Massachusetts Department of Transportation to kind of remind us where we are in the arc of this study, what we're trying to accomplish, and what the collective work that we all need to do throughout the summer is. So we set out to do this study at MassDOT because for years, if not decades, the concept of some form of higher speed rail from Western Massachusetts, whether that's Springfield or Pittsfield, to Boston by way of Worcester has been an important concept and a rallying cry, but it never quite seemed to make the leap from an idea that had a lot of resonance for people to an actual project. And I will tell you, after more than 5 years as Secretary of Transportation, that there is a fundamental difference between being a thing that you study and a project that you build. And at some point, if we are all serious about East-West passenger rail, it has to make that transition. And it is my hope that that through this study, we can lay the groundwork for that transition. It's still a study, this is still a study, but if we all work hard together, by the end of this study, we might actually have the foundations of a project that can then move more conventionally through the project development process. So where we had hoped to be at this point in time when we began this effort was pretty much finishing up and getting together in June to celebrate all the great work we've done. That obviously didn't happen, but it still can. It will just take us probably till September rather than until June, as we will talk about today. But the fundamental steps in the process are the same as the ones we laid out at the beginning of the study. We started with understanding what the desires were. We put together six different alternatives that in various ways and to varying degrees met the criteria that people were looking from. We had a good discussion when we laid out our initial cost estimates and ridership estimates and environmental impacts of those six alternatives. And that's kind of when we were last together, is we had both the advisory committee and the public conversation about the information that we laid out at that last phase. Since then, I do want to assure you that we have taken all of those comments and that feedback very seriously. And we have repeatedly asked the consultant team and the staff to go back and poke at things and take a look and redo work and rethink assumptions. And you're going to hear today about that work and what the results are and the rethinking that has gone on. I hope that some of it will make you feel good about the fact that we heard what you said and have actually developed, as you'll hear, not one but two new methodologies for forecasting ridership that we think more accurately capture the potential of East-West rail. Other things that people, you know, surfaced, we did take a look at but did not as of yet choose to make any changes in study methodology as a result. That doesn't mean that they weren't important points or that the feedback wasn't important. It just means we're not at that point. And this is what I would say to you is my most important message. In the way that we set this study up, there's a point at which we need to narrow it to three alternatives. And then we can go back to those three and we can take another hard look at what we think their ridership will be, what they think they will cost, how long they will take to build, what the alternatives are for paying for them, a not inconsequential question. we think we're at that point. We understand it may take a little bit of time. We all need to shake off some cobwebs, remind ourselves what the six alternatives were, remind ourselves what was concerning us about the various methodologies. So we are not expecting at the end of today's meeting that people are ready to sort of do a show of hands and pick three alternatives. Although if you want to do that, we're good. But we also don't want to push people to feel that they have to do that today when they've barely thought about this for many weeks or months. So we'll walk you through the additional analytic work that's been done. Nancy will walk you through the process of thinking about how you get from six to three. And then we're going to give everybody a week or so to internalize all this new information, think, maybe talk to colleagues. But we would like to do a test and then see how close are we to agreeing on three final alternatives. If we're there in a week, then we can continue the study as we had planned. We'll go back and we'll do our additional homework on cost estimation and ridership modeling, and then we'll get back to you. And then by the end of the summer and early September, we want to have another advisory meeting, another public meeting. We want to have a draft document that you can actually all read and give us comments on. And we want to put together a final set of recommendations on what the next steps are and how we really make that pivot from finishing the study part of the life of East West Rail to moving into the, it's an early stage project, not just an idea. I hope that people are ready to do that, but we will take our signals from you. If you're not, we'll try to give you a little extra time, but I would say to you that the world is changing around us. The budget situation on both the capital and the operating side is not what any of us would like it to be, and we're not sure when that's going to change. But we also have members of the Massachusetts delegation, including Chairman Neal and Congressman McGovern and Senator Markey and Senator Warren, who are all fighting really hard for infrastructure dollars. And infrastructure dollars, whether they go to shovel-ready projects or not-so-shovel-ready projects, they go to projects. They don't go to ideas. So if we can all work together through the remainder of this study project to lay the groundwork for pivoting from an idea to something that's much more closer to a project, then we may be able to capitalize on any federal resources that are made available with the help of our delegation and that of the other states. So again, we're trying to balance between not pushing the advisory committee farther or faster than you're ready to go, but also acknowledging that the time has come to advance this work, to catch up a little bit on the time we fell behind, hopefully to move within the next week or so to three alternatives, and then for us to do that work and reconvene late in the summer and finish this up. Not because this is the end of East West, but because it was always anticipated to be a first but major step in the life of East West Passenger Rail as a project. And we have to finish this piece of that work to be able to move into the next steps, which I know many of you are eager to do. So I'm going to turn you back into Nancy's able hands and Emily and Astrid Zahn and Ethan and David Moeller and our consultant team. I can't stay with you for the entire meeting today, but I will get reports on it, and I do look forward to circling back with you and hearing how things went and working together with all of you to build on the foundation that we've already laid in this study process to take it to the next level. Nancy, thanks very much.
Thank you, Secretary. I appreciate you joining us and really helping everyone to remember what our charges are for today and for the next few months. I want to acknowledge that we've had a few legislators join us, and forgive me if I don't see everyone. I'm reading this little tiny list here. But I think I saw Representative Pignatelli, Jonathan Butler from the 1st Berkshire, Representative McGovern's office is here, John's here. Let's see, Representative Lindsay Sabadosa, and Senator Comerford, and Senator Lesser, Senator Hines. That's all I see at the moment, but forgive me if I didn't catch you all. We will go back again. I don't know, these systems are good, but not perfect. So anyway, welcome again to the fifth meeting of the Advisory Committee, our first virtual meeting. I'm gonna read some rules and regs on how we'll make this operate efficiently, I hope for everyone, because there are constraints and we can't just have a big screen with all of us talking at the same time. So my name, by the way, is Nancy Farrell. As you can see, I'm going to be moderating the meeting. I'm a member of the team and working on the public outreach. So all attendees will be muted during the presentation to prevent background noise. I had to hide all my phones. There are lawnmowers. There are all sorts of things I know that we all hear when we're on these calls. We're going to ask advisory committee members to hold your questions and comments until a certain point in the presentation. Ethan is going to bring everyone up to speed on the new information that came from your requests. So when we get to that point, we'll pause and you'll be invited to use the raise hand button, and we'll put that on the screen so you can see it. If you would like to speak, you can click on the participants button and you'll see that where your name is, and you can hit the raise hand. We'll recognize you, and then after you have given us your comment or question, then we'll lower your hand and we'll return you to mute. And really, that's just for efficiency. We love to hear what everyone has to say, but we only have so much time this afternoon. At the end of the meeting, we've allowed time for public comment. If you're a member of the public and you'd like to share a comment or ask a question, you can use the Q&A feature, which is in the bottom center of your screen, to submit a typed question or a comment at any point during the meeting. We would ask you only to submit one at this time, so to make it more efficient. And we will, if we don't have enough time to answer them all today, we will answer them in writing, and we'll let you know when those answers are available. We'll do our best to get to as many as possible. When you raise your hand, you again will be unmuted. I'll call your name, wait a second, takes a couple seconds, and then you may speak. We won't be enabling video because fortunately there are just too many people on the call, so we won't be able to do that. At the end of the meeting, you will see how you can write a question or comment to Michaela. And again, this presentation's on the website, so you can also go to the website to get that information. Let's see now. I think what I want to do next is introduce our team members. I'm sure you've probably met Ethan Britlin and Michaela Niles. They are our co-project managers. Drew Galloway is our consultant from WSP and our project manager. And Ned Codd is the deputy PM from WSP. Laura McWorthy is our ridership modeler from AECOM. And Emily Christian works with me from RVA, and she's going to be conducting the train today as we go forward. So Ethan, I think we're ready. We can probably slip past the, a little bit about the agenda. What we're going to do is I will talk a little bit about what our view is of the public feedback we heard a few months ago. Then Ethan is going to deal with the more technical aspects, such as the cost estimate, the refinement of the ridership modeling. Then we're going to pause and ask for any questions from the advisory committee, because there's a fair amount of information to digest in the first part of the presentation. Then we'll go back into kind of a review of where we are, remembering the six alternatives, trying to get some sense of how you feel about them, and we'll have a discussion and selection about the goal, as the secretary mentioned, to move to three final alternatives. And then we'll talk a little bit about next steps. And I think we're ready to go, Emily. There we go. Okay. So this is a high-level summary of the things that we heard from you over the last public meeting and advisory committee meeting in particular. One thing I think everyone was concerned about is that the capital cost estimates differed from the ones that were presented for NERI, the Northern New England Initiative, and those study cost estimates differed, so we're going to deal with that issue. Ridership forecasts also differed from NERI, so we're going to address those. I think there's a strong feeling that the 20-mile radius around the station for potential riders was too small, and a strong feeling, especially in Western Mass, that people in rural areas would drive further than that distance to get to the service, and that ridership may not have really reflected demand, particularly in the Five College area. In addition, people felt that the ridership forecast did not include induced demand, new commuters, new business, personal, and recreational travel. And so Ethan is going to take on these topics. And then again, we'll pause to hear your comments and questions before moving on. All right, Ethan, you're up.
Thank you, Nancy. Mm-hmm. Just wanted to say, hello, everyone. Thank you. And again, my name is Ethan Britland. I'm the MassDOT co-project manager along with Michaela Niles. It's a big effort, so we definitely need two folks on the job. So before we get into detail, following slide, Emily. Thank you. So before we get into the detail of our costing, we just want to be clear on some of our key assumptions for our cost estimates for the six preliminary alternatives. We followed federal guidelines, thinking ahead to potential funding sources. Our quantities were based on our alternatives development, so they are still conceptual. Our unit costs were based on recent construction projects in the state and region. We didn't want to look at national numbers per se. We wanted to look at numbers that were more relevant to our area. So we took a very standard approach to our costing. But the primary takeaway is that the study had always assumed that we would refine the cost estimates for the final three alternatives. So at a conceptual level for six alternatives, we have one level of costing, and then as we refine them, there will be some differences, changes, but that's all part of the refinement process. And we understand there was a lot of big numbers and boiled down numbers at the last set of February meetings. So we're going to, as part of our final three alternatives, provide more detail on how we broke down those costings. So I just wanted to lead with how we developed our cost estimates. Next slide. So one of our biggest feedback comments was that the NERI study and the East-West study had significantly different cost estimates. We wanted to highlight that the two studies do have some key geographic differences. A primary one being that our East-West study includes a 52-mile segment between Pittsfield and Springfield along the CSX line, which NERI did not include. It's not just mileage. The segment has 22 bridge crossings of the Westfield River, and it's through very mountainous terrain, which, as you can imagine, can be challenging, and it affects the overall costing for East-West alternatives that have rail to Pittsfield. Next, please. On the Springfield to Worcester segment, NERI did not assume CSX guidance for physical separation of the freight and passenger tracks on the double track restoration. East-West, we followed CSX guidance, and by doing that, it assumed that we'd realign tracks, associated utility relocations. And the biggest difference was we assumed bridge reconstruction for double track restoration rather than rehabilitation. And this accounted for much of the difference between the two studies. And again, as we come back for our final three, we will break them down in a different way to make them more easily digestible and understandable. So on this slide, we wanted to show the cost per mile for our six preliminary alternatives. So based on the geographical differences from NERI, the fact that we followed CSX guidance, and combined with the overall length of the corridor, we don't feel the costs are out of proportion. For example, South Coast Rail is over $1 billion, and that's only 36 miles. But again, these were preliminary cost estimates. We had always intended on refining them. And this is all part of a conceptual study where we look at many concepts, we winnow it down to a fewer concepts, and as they move forward into any project development, the costs will continue to get refined. So we're going to transition to our ridership methodology on the following slides. One of the other things we heard loud and clear was that the East-West preliminary ridership numbers in comparison to NERI were not consistent. To be clear, we use the NERI ridership model as a base for East-West study for a few reasons. The primary reason was consistency. It's very standard in transportation planning to use a prior study's work, such as NERI, to conduct a follow-up study. I would even say that if we hadn't used NERI, it would be viewed as an oversight, especially when the NERI study was used for federal permitting. And it was generally accepted by the stakeholders and public. Additionally, there was also direct overlap on the Boston to Springfield segment. So when we looked more closely at the NERI data, And when comparing the common segment, Springfield to Boston, NERI's preferred alternative had an estimate of around 50,000 riders. East-West's alternative three, which is most NERI-like in terms of frequency and travel time, had a preliminary ridership of about 48,000. The takeaway from this slide is essentially that NERI's ridership by segment was similar to East-West's preliminary ridership numbers. Next slide, please. But as already noted, we received a lot of feedback, which is an integral and iterative part of our public process. And so we've examined the following ways to refine and we feel enhance the ridership forecasting methodology, which is what we will apply to the three final alternatives. So very quickly, we'll get into more detail on the following slides, but we looked at our proxy rail service. Because of limited service along the East-West corridor right now, we have to use a comparative service in order to calculate our ridership. We looked at our station catchment areas, and we also looked at induced demand in the context of the proxy services. Next slide, please. So here, I just wanted to highlight that our original forecasting was done based on a Hartford line proxy. Again, this was based on the NERI model. It was adjusted, but this is what we use for our initial ridership forecasting. And it has a similar geographic area as East-West. And again, it was used in the NERI model before. So we also looked at what we're calling an enhanced Hartford line proxy. We expanded it to include New Haven as a larger market station or pair. So essentially, this almost mimics the Springfield, Worcester, Boston look of having Hartford in the middle as a larger draw as well. So we felt this one, by expanding to include New Haven, it sort of mimicked the East-West corridor a bit more. We also looked at switching to the Downeaster service as a proxy. This one is similar in many ways to East-West in terms of mileage. Starting up in Brunswick, Maine, serves a more rural market, and also it serves the Boston market, which the Hartford line doesn't. So we also had to conduct refinements on both of them, but that's that was just standard for proxy services. Next slide. We wanted to talk a bit about the station catchment areas. There's a lot of different ways that transportation models can look at transit or travel ridership. And in this case, we have a straight line catchment area for our stations. We essentially have a station point, draw a line out a certain distance, and then just draw a circle. We obviously have to modify the buffers so that they don't overlap. But I think what we wanted to highlight here is there was a concern about driving distances versus our straight line distances. So we just want to be clear that in looking at the graphic, you can see that a 40 mile straight line buffer can result in a driving distance greater than 40 miles simply because driving is not typically in a straight line or at a constant speed. So we wanted to show the difference because there were concerns about in rural areas, there might be a propensity to drive longer distances. Next slide, please. So with that said, we have examined three potential station catchment areas. The first one is the one we used in our preliminary ridership forecasts. This one, we understand after looking at it that it required transfers with connecting north-south rail service. For example, the Springfield Station buffer zone is compressed down to avoid overlap with the Holyoke Station on the Vermonter service. We also looked at a 40 mile catchment, which we agree captures a greater rural population, but we feel may overestimate ridership due to driving distances being, can be greater than 40 miles. So our third one here is what we felt was more appropriate for to have a 20 mile catchment, but then we adjusted the Springfield Station catchment area And what that does is it releases the constraint of the Vermonter stations. It allows riders to drive directly to Springfield. At least the model assumes riders could drive directly to Springfield rather than have to take a connecting service. We think this better accounts for student populations. The following slides are going to have some graphics that highlight what we just talked about here. So again, this is the 40-mile catchment. While it certainly captures a much greater rural population, it also captures a majority of the state and neighboring states. We feel it may skew the ridership between stations, meaning the outer edge of one station buffer may actually be closer to an adjacent station. Or in this case, Greenfield, for example, a rider or driver may find it more convenient to head directly east and drive to, let's say, an MBTA station rather than heading south to an east-west train. So transitioning to the next slide, Emily. So again, this is our 20-mile catchment. As you can see, the 20-mile catchment minimizes distortion between the stations to avoid overlapping. And we also have drawn circles around Holyoke and Northampton just for illustrative purposes. We feel this best captures the population employment centers that are likely to use rail stations, but I just wanted to highlight that in our prior ridership analysis, the Springfield station compressed down under the Holyoke circle. So what we've done is we've expanded the Springfield station up to above Northampton so that it can adequately capture commute or demand from the Five Colleges area and from students and or workers. Next slide, please. Something else we looked at was induced demand. In this context, induced demand is defined as new trips above the forecasted ridership that may occur from employers or people choosing to locate or relocate as a result of any new service. So when we looked at the Hartford line, we felt it would be appropriate to include some level of induced demand on top of our forecasting for the enhanced Hartford line proxy, because it is a relatively new service and still growing. However, we think that the Downeaster proxy ridership should not include induced demand because it has been running for quite a while and we feel that it is a mature service. So any of that induced demand we feel is embedded or implicit in the ridership already. And if we included induced demand, we feel it would be double counting some ridership if we did. So for those reasons, we felt it was appropriate to not include induced demand in the Downeaster service. So based on the background work, examination of stations, station catchment, induced demand in the Springfield station, we have two new ridership forecast scenarios that we tested on alternative three. And we propose to use these on the final three alternatives. We used alternative three because we felt it was most nearly like it was rail for the entire corridor and it was generally supported by the AC and public. So again, we have our two, we have our enhanced Hartford line proxy and our Downeaster proxy. They both have a 20-mile catchment for the stations. We included induced demand in the Hartford line proxy. We did not include induced demand in Downeaster, but we did make the Springfield station buffer adjustment to both of them. And next slide, please. So what does that mean and how will we use what we learned? So these two new scenarios, they increased ridership by a factor of 4 to 5 times, not 4 to 5%, but 4 to 5 times. We understand that there is a significant increase, but we feel this new range represents the likely range of ridership given our available data tools. And again, we plan on using this for analysis of the final three alternatives. For this slide, we wanted to provide some context compared to South Coast Rail, which is the most expensive state-funded project we've done to date, transit project. And what does that mean for metrics like cost per rider? Even with the new ridership range and using our preliminary cost estimates, the cost per rider is still 6 to 8 times higher than South Coast Rail. So that doesn't mean that a project cannot get funding, but we have to be concerned about metrics like this when we are when we're going to move into the next phase of project development. Next slide is also meant to complement this slide. Now, what does this new ridership range mean for benefit cost analysis, and why are we bringing this up? And there's two acronyms here. There's BCA and BCR. They're essentially the same thing, but BCR is really what we want to use and focus on. Typically, projects looking to receive any kind of federal funding would need to conduct a benefit cost analysis, which again, we express it as a BCR ratio, benefit to cost ratio. A ratio of 1.0 or higher historically makes a project more competitive. For illustrative purposes, we've looked at alternative 3 with the new ridership range. And as you can see with initial calculations, it results in BCRs much lower than 1.0. We want to highlight this for a few reasons. One, in advance of our discussion about final three alternatives, because there will be trade-offs with costs and benefits. But we also wanted to highlight this because it would mean, while we do think we would look for federal funding, it may be that we would have to look at other funding sources as well. One note we wanted to make is that recently proposed legislation from Senator Markey does not depend on a BCA. But we do want to be cognizant of all potential funding sources that may rely on a BCA. So we're going to pause there. That was a lot of information we threw at you. And so we want to pause and take questions from the advisory committee.
Yes, and there, here we go. Here is how to submit a question. And let me just say that we do have representatives from Senator Markey's office and from Representative McGovern and Representative Neal's offices. So we also have, let's see, 101 participants. So thank you all for joining us today. I'm going to ask any advisory committee members who have a question to raise your hand. And I know, as Ethan said, we've given you a lot of information. Before we go on to discussing the three final alternative choices, we thought this was a good time to pause and you could ask questions. I'll remind you also that this presentation is on the website, so that afterwards you can go back and look at the details and refresh your memory as we continue to move the study forward. And I don't see any hands up. Emily, do you? Panelists, you are free to raise your hands. That would be advisory committee members. Senator Lesser, looks like you have a question or a statement. Emily, will you unmute Senator Lesser?
Can you hear me?
We can, thank you.
So first, thank you so much, you know, for this, and thank you to Secretary Pollack and to the team. It's good news overall, the ridership estimate being increased. I do have several points that I think are important to just repeat. I know I've shared this with MassDOT privately as well, but you know, first, I think that I still feel strongly that the ridership estimates are far, far, far below where they should be, and where I think kind of common sense would indicate they would be. First, the comparison to the CT rail line, I think is inappropriate for a variety of reasons. Using the Hartford New Haven line as a comparison to Springfield Boston or Pittsfield Boston, I just don't think is comparable. Anecdotally, I have a neighbor who lives around the corner from me who commutes to New Haven for work. New Haven is a much smaller city than Boston. New Haven is a much less expensive city to live in than Boston. So is Hartford, and both Hartford and New Haven have a lot cheaper and more accessible parking than Boston, and are not growing as fast as Boston or have the same attractive job opportunities that Boston has. So I don't think that those comparisons are accurate. I think that benchmark is dragging the ridership estimate down. Portland is a better comparison, but even Portland, I would point out, the city of Portland has a population of 66,000 people. The city of Springfield has a population of 155,000. The city of Portland as a metro area, the Portland metropolitan region, has a population of 514,000. The Springfield metropolitan statistical area has over 600,000. And you have Worcester in between, which is a region of about a million. I'd also say that the comparisons are missing some very obvious other regional links that I think are important to look at that are more accurate, especially Boston to Providence. Providence and Springfield are roughly the same size. There's no comparison of Boston to Providence. Chicago, South Bend. South Bend is smaller than Springfield. It's about 100,000, but it's about 90 miles from Chicago, just like Springfield's about 90 miles from from Boston. Stockton, San Francisco. Stockton is a little over 80 miles from San Francisco. Springfield's about 90 miles from Boston. San Francisco and Boston are really peer cities in terms of economic growth, in terms of cost of living. Stockton and Springfield are comparable in size. I'd also point out Beacon, New York to New York City. Beacon in the Hudson Valley, roughly the same size, has a lot of similar characteristics to Pittsfield. There's no comparison between the Beacon, New York route in terms of ridership for Pittsfield, Boston. I don't say on induced demand. I still consider the induced demand calculation to just not really be reflective of common sense. If you look at every major development project in Massachusetts right now, the Riverside project in Newton, the Assembly Row project in Somerville, North Point in Cambridge, Hub on Causeway, the City Square Worcester Red Sox development in Worcester, all of them came years, if not decades, after the rail links were established. So the induced demand calculation is not just about the opportunity it's creating today or tomorrow, but the opportunity for growth and development it's creating for years and decades into the future. And I don't think that the induced demand calculation right now factors that in. So I hope that those get built in a little bit more. And I also hope that that environmental benefits, greenhouse gas reductions, and the overall affordability changes it will create for the state overall, especially in a period now of very high unemployment, are factored in as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. We'll take those comments into consideration. I know you shared them earlier with the Secretary. Do we have any other questions or comments from the Advisory Committee members?
Looks like Kimberly Robinson.
Oh, great, thank you. Kimberly, we're unmuting you.
Thank you so much for that. I appreciate it. And thank you for the opportunity to chat over all of these items with you today as part of the steering committee. One of the questions that I have is a good understanding of both the economic impacts that this additional rail line could provide for our region. So I'm thinking about, kind of the effects, whether we talk about transit-oriented development, additional economic development opportunities. Obviously, it's the opportunity for folks who maybe are living someplace where housing is so expensive to live further away once there is an established train schedule. And my second question is the conversation around the benefits of an inland route for the future, for the entire country, how that consideration came into the analysis as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. So to the first question, as far as economic benefits, we are going to quantify some shorter term benefits, but something like a longer term look would have to be done through a separate process. There are a lot of other associated processes that look at future demographic data, economic development, and a lot of state agencies, as well as regional and local entities use these numbers. So something that would look at the transformative nature of an East-West rail service would have to be done as a follow-up study or as future project development permitting. And to your second question, could you repeat the question, the second one, in terms of inland route?
Holly, can you unmute Kim?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks. My question was really about, it's a follow-on from the NERI study that I read, and the benefits of having an additional inland route in terms of, you know, resiliency, whether it's around climate change or economic development, things like that. And so that plays into, at least in my mind, how important it could be to establish this route. I understand it's going to be difficult to try and quantify that, and yet I think it's something that we shouldn't lose sight of. And so I was wondering how you were dealing with it in your analysis.
So as far as the overall inland route, you know, the service that NERI looked at up to Montreal and down south into New York, Connecticut, New York, we did not model that as part of our study. Our charge was east-west service, but we do account for connecting services. But that's not to say that any future looks at long-term visioning wouldn't start looking at longer service, building upon the effort we're doing here with east-west passenger rail service.
Thank you, Kim. Do we have other comments or questions from the advisory committee? Just raise a hand, please. Everyone's still thinking, even.
Rep Sabadosa?
Oh, great. How are you seeing me so fast?
I just saw. Sorry.
Thank you very much. I wanted to clarify your answer to that last question, actually. So in all of this modeling, we're not taking into account the potential for the connections through New York? Because of course with the Valley Flyer, we're talking constantly about the number of rioters that are coming from New York City up into the Valley and going down and vice versa. It's a major transportation thoroughfare. I mean, I think it's highly acknowledged that there are deep connections between Western Massachusetts and New York City. And so if we're not taking into account that we are already having people come up from the city that could potentially go out to Boston, it feels like we are missing an enormous number of potential riders.
So again, this is not the NERI study, which did look at that longer route. That's not to say that you're right, there is a connection between Western Mass and south into Connecticut and New York. But again, our charge was east-west service. We do account for it in connecting service. So it's not something that was part of our geography. And so you do have to put a line, so to speak, in your studies. And so we didn't go that far in our study.
Thank you, Representative. Emily, I think Linda LaDuke is ready to ask a question or make a comment.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Hi. Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to comment on the ridership radius. I know that there was extended to 40 miles beyond the Union Station in Springfield, but my concern is that if it remains at 20 miles around the Palmer Station, that we're not actually capturing the potential ridership within that 21 community, the Lower Quabbin region, that the study that we submitted early on in this process. I think that although rural and the numbers would maybe be huge, I still think it's an important region to consider serving. There could be a great amount of induced demand response with a station in Palmer. So I was just wondering if it would be possible. I just think there's a big gap that of an area that isn't going to be served, a rural area that isn't going to be served by only looking at a 20-mile radius from a Palmer station, understanding that you can't have a 40-mile radius from every station because this, of course, there's significant overlap. But I do think that there's a rural region that isn't being served by minimizing that or maintaining the 20-mile radius from Palmer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that comment. We appreciate it. Let's see. Any other questions or let's see. I'll go to Travis since he hasn't asked a question yet. Emily, can you open up Travis there?
Yeah, this is, I'm curious. First of all, I want to say I'm sorry that Mark Drayson could not join the meeting. I know he had a technical problem, but I will brief him later. So, but one thing I wanted to ask was in terms of the capital costs, you mentioned that the next three, I guess once we get down to three alternatives, there'll be capital costs will be looked at in more detail. I was curious if you discussed this or if you didn't, I apologize. What are the other details in terms of capital costs that will be looked at in the next three alternatives?
Thank you, Travis. So when we talk about refinement, we take a closer look at, you know, unit costing, the units themselves. So it's going through again, but as we know more about the alternatives and as we refine the alternatives themselves, there's going to be changes and adjustments to the costing. But I think it sounds like you're more asking, I think the idea is we want to go back to the advisory committee after our final three and show them in a different way, I guess, is a better way to describe it. Because at our February meetings, we just kind of threw large capital cost numbers out there. You know, there's a lot that goes into those numbers. Just the overall costing itself, there are soft costs, there are contingencies, there's rolling stock. So we want to show in more detail what goes into those very large numbers we had shown so that we can hopefully help people understand, you know, what those large numbers mean. They're not just a number on a piece of paper. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that helps. So it's more of just understanding the costs, and it's not that it doesn't sound like you're going to be refining the costs very much.
It's a combination of both. There will be certainly numbers different, but we also want to just show more of the detail of what goes into those actual large numbers as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So Ethan, you know, I took out my map here on slide 14. It does look like the 20 mile buffer north and south of Palmer goes quite a distance. South, it goes into Connecticut. Linda, I'd suggest you take a look at that, and then just, you know, when you're sending us comments, let us know what you think of that. Any more questions or comments? We will move on to discussing the three final alternative issues if there are no other questions at the moment. Ethan and Emily, I don't see any at the moment.
I don't either.
Okay. I'll give you a few seconds, folks, to see if you have any more questions, and then we will move on. It's so much nicer to see everyone's face, wouldn't it, Ethan?
Yeah, understand.
But there are 102 faces we'd have to put on the screen right now, so. All right. So, moving on. So this is where, as the secretary says, we're going to try to figure out how we move from an idea to a project. And that requires, since we can't look at all six of these as in more detail as described by Ethan, it requires you to give us your thoughts on the three final alternatives for further analysis. Just as a reminder, MassDOT has presented some considerations that we hope you'll take into account. Not limited to these, but including feasibility, ridership, and cost effectiveness. And then the advisory committee and the public feedback on priorities for East-West have included this list, which is rail service for the full corridor and no bus connections to Pittsfield, frequent service to intermediate stops such as Palmer and Chester, frequent service, faster speeds, and lower travel times. And the ridership, you saw the refinements only for alternative three. Going forward, they will be applied to all the final alternatives for further analysis. Next slide. So as a reminder, the alternatives, the preliminary alternatives fit into three different categories. The first numbers 1 through 3 are in a shared corridor on the existing alignment. And the first numbers 1 and 2 do include bus service, transfers from Pittsfield to Springfield. Number three is shared existing corridor alignment. It's upgraded and realigned, and it is from Boston to Pittsfield. So those are the green shaded services that you're looking at. If we look to four and five, those are a shared corridor, but number four is a new separate track, and number five is a new track and a realignment. Number five does include some bus service, so that should be noted. And the kind of pinkish one is the separate corridor. This is the one that parallels I-90, the Mass Pike, and it's high-speed rail. Now the presentation for your use will kind of spin through the next couple slides, Emily, because you will have this information to look at in more detail as you prepare to give us comments on what your preferred three alternatives are. I'm not going to address all of the issues right now, such as travel time, ridership, capital cost, and things like that. But you'll have this presentation on the website so you can refer to it and use it to make your judgments and decisions. So Emily, we can just kind of roll through the next couple of pages just to remind people that all this information is available to them. And the next one, great. And we had to split this up really actually to make the presentation accessible. And I apologize, it took us longer than we expected, which is why it was not on the presentation was not on the website as early as we wanted today. So the next part of the meeting is really a discussion, you telling us what you think and any other questions you'd like us to answer as we begin to approach, as the secretary said, more in-depth discussion of the three alternatives. Let's go to the next slide. I've just reminded you in brief what those what each of the alternatives is. I will summarize that, especially since we've heard a lot about the bus, we are interested in your comments. There is bus service included in alternatives 1, 2, and 5. So going forward, we would like to hear your thoughts about the effect of including the bus service and what that would do to any of the alternatives that you are thinking about. Next slide, please. Something else that we talked about at the meeting in February was about a hybrid being included as one of the three final alternatives. So a hybrid would include, parts of one or two of the alternatives for under consideration. For example, we developed this hybrid idea, which is a hybrid of 4 and 5 that would include the Pittsfield to Boston rail elements from alternative 4 and the most promising elements of alternative 5 that would speed up the service. So it's more likely that the cost would be higher than alternative 4, but travel time would be lower than alternative 5. So this is the kind of thing that might be interesting to pursue and to discuss as we go into the next part of the meeting. Next slide, Emily. And then the other thing that we talked about last time at our February meeting was looking at one or more of these alternatives as part of a phase project. I know that I used the South Coast Rail example the last time, but think about the possibility of choosing an alternative and then developing a phased approach to it. For example, South Coast Rail for more than a year as the beginning of the major construction into a phased project started on early action projects such as grade crossings, culverts, railroad bridges, developing a budget to approach elements of the preferred, the final alternative for South Coast Rail, which have been taking place over the last year while the budget and the financing was coming together for the entire phase one project. And happy to say that the phase one project is gonna be under construction by the end of this year. So that's been a successful way to look at a project. Now, as Ethan reminded us, there are metrics such as the benefit cost analysis that we have to take into consideration in considering phasing. But those are all things that in the next steps in our discussion and our study that we can take a look at. So at this point, Ethan, I think, next slide, please. I think we want to have a conversation before we go into this, unless you want to just share with people what will happen after we have their three alternatives.
Yeah, so I see some raised hands, but let's just quickly, I'll just say, so, you know, if we, whenever we do get to consensus on a final three alternatives, we are going to conduct the ridership forecast using the range, the two ranges, I should say the two proxies to develop a range. We are looking more closely at rail traffic controller simulation, which is making sure that the trains can run on the tracks together, both passenger and freight. We'll, again, final cost estimates, benefit cost analysis, and also looking at a high level funding and revenue assessment. After that, we go back to the advisory committee and in the public to present all this work. And then hopefully we can move forward with a draft report with findings and advisory committee recommendations. We then put it out for 30-day public comment, take comments, and issue a final report. And that's sort of, as the secretary noted, this is, there are steps that need to be completed in order to move projects forward. And so this is a conceptual step that we need to tie up in order to be able to move forward with anything. So with that said, there are two raised hands. Rep. Pignatelli?
Yeah. Emily, Representative Pignatelli?
Can you hear me okay?
I can, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you, Ethan and Emily and Nancy for a fine job here today. I'm going to sound like a broken record, but I very easily could go from the 6 to 3 right now.
Okay.
I'll say what I said 6 months ago. Anything that has a bus only from the Berkshires to Springfield should be eliminated immediately. This is a generational investment we're going to be making. I believe, you know, the cost benefit analysis and the ridership, we can debate those all day long. They're clearly just a snapshot in time. That's all they are. This is such a long-term process. When there's a shovel to be put in the ground, we could do that cost benefit analysis and a ridership study again, and then the numbers will be dramatically different once more. So I don't think we should spend a lot of time at this early stage of the cost, or let's not get hung up on the cost or the ridership debate at this point. I would propose reducing the options to number 3, number 4, and number 6, and eliminate immediately number 1, number 2, and number 5. And I wish you would all call it west-east instead of east-west. I'll echo that again, but 3, 4, and 6, I don't know how we're going to vote on these things, and I don't think we need to wait a week, to be very honest with you, to do that. I think there's pretty much consensus. We've understood the options. Not much has changed since we met a few months ago with those 6 options. And if we're voting, I would make a motion right now that we accept 3, 4, and 6.
Well, thank you, sir. The secretary has asked us to give people a little bit of time to comment. Because it's been a while, as she said, since we met, and there is some new information to consider, but definitely we do call you the bus killer for sure. Thank you. Senator Hines, I see you have your hand up.
Hi, thanks a lot. I didn't intend to tag team with Representative Pignatelli on this, but I guess I'm concerned that we still are talking in terms of busing and how it's dangerously dividing the advocates for connecting our Commonwealth, and starts to take away from the coherence of our ability to talk about this and advocate for it and recognize the validity and the need for an investment for the Commonwealth. As soon as we start spending now weeks and months ahead talking about you know, are the Berkshires going to undermine the ability for Palmer to have a higher speed train? It's incredibly unproductive, and I think that in itself is a reason to get rid of 1, 2, and 5. Am I looking at this right? Anyway, it's not in front of me, but the ones with the bus.
Yes.
Right. Thanks. And so, you know, the conversation about the hybrids of trains, like that's a little more interesting, but it's all still focused on trains. So I appreciate the, so that's that point. The second point is, this is something I've raised before, is that we're still giving up on this concept that the relevance of the neighboring capital in New York City, or New York State, sorry. And so by continuing the train to Pittsfield, so three of the options, we're opening ourselves up to yet another major economic boon and quality of life and kind of huge impact in the western part of the Commonwealth by doing that. And so I raised it at the previous one, and it doesn't look like that's entered the analysis. And yet I feel like it's a relevant piece that may not resonate in the ears of people in Boston, but it is where we live our lives out here and get our news from, in fact. And so it's a very relevant piece, albeit, you know, one that's on top of that, one that would is a significant capital in our nation. So I wanted to underscore that point as well as further contributing to the reason why we would look at 3, 4, and 6 and a piece that still isn't being considered significantly as a factor for why that would be a good idea.
Thank you, Senator. At the risk of, since we've heard no bus quite a few times in these meetings, I'd like to ask the members of the advisory committee who are on the call, if you'd be willing to raise your hand if you would like to remove 1, 2, and 5. Those are the bus options. If you would like to remove 1, 2, and 5 from further consideration. And if somebody can count, it looks like there's a lot of hands up. Okay.
It's looking like you don't have to count. It's just it's everyone.
Like I don't have to count, exactly.
No, it actually isn't. But so I think the idea behind the no bus, I think alternative 5 has bus elements in it, but when we talk about a hybrid, I think that's where the alternative 5 comes into consideration.
Right, and it could have, right, an hybrid or a phased element, it could, but it seems like the bus, I think that it's fair to say that the bus, there's not much of anyone in favor of carrying the strictly bus alternatives into the final next step. All right, who else have we got? I think we need to lower the voting hands or the polling hands, okay. And then we can see who, okay. Other comments? Mm-hmm. I see, let's see. I don't know if those are still vote, those are polls or, okay, how about, Linda, did you want to have another question?
Yes, please.
Okay, go ahead.
I wonder, you presented one hybrid idea, and I wonder if the consultant team or MassDOT has thought of any other hybrids that we should be thinking about. I'm a little concerned that the advisory committee is being asked to potentially come up with hybrid solutions, and yet we're not the consultant team. So some thinking and advice and what you've thought about would be super helpful.
Yes, so thank you, Linda. I think understanding that, you know, not everyone's as technical as the team. There's obviously hybrids that maybe we haven't thought about, but what we were thinking of as a team in terms of hybrid is something like alternative 4, but taking what we've talked about it before, what are called priority realignments, and they can be costly, but they're areas that we try to straighten the track in order to gain travel time or lower travel time and gain speed. And that's part of alternative 5. So that was what we have been thinking about in terms of a hybrid, something that is obviously all rail, no bus, but incorporates some these realignments to reduce the travel time. So that's sort of what we're thinking.
And Ethan, could other hybrids come up in the next phase? Is that something that people could, that could be discussed?
Most definitely. Typically as project development starts, it goes through permitting, and environmental permitting looks at alternatives again. They looks at what we put forward as part of our study, but there is a public process as part of any permitting, and that's where other hybrid alternatives could be developed. It could be developed as part of a team that is looking at any kind of project development. So yes, it's not a done deal. It's just more at a conceptual level, what kind of hybrid alternative would we like to look at as part of the final three? And again, we're doing more analysis for final three. We're not trying to focus in on one right now. We really want to look at a range. So, I think it's open to ideas.
Thank you. I see Representative Smith, you have your hand up again?
No, I didn't have my hand up.
Oh, sorry. Okay. And Linda, we just...
Thanks for remembering me, though.
Travis, is yours up? Are you...
Yes. Just a couple more, comments or questions. I think we really do need the time to digest this a little bit more. I mean, I understand people wanting to, maybe get rid of some options. I really understand that Mark, Grayson, and I talked about this, and we really like to have the time to just look at this a little bit more. Everyone's had to deal with COVID and everything for the last few months, and this is we need the week to, or some time to really digest this, but I appreciate everything you put in here. I think it'd be interesting, I want to think about possible hybrids, maybe of something like between 4 and 6. I'm kind of curious as to what the options are, that like which of a brand new alignment along I-90 or something similar has the most benefit and utility to the travel time, and which ones maybe, are more costly and don't have as much benefit. So I'd be curious if there's some option there that might be helpful. I don't know, 6 is, I think almost the entire right of way is on a new corridor, or at least a good portion of it. Perhaps there could be something that's a hybrid of that. But another question I have coming up is, and I apologize if you discussed this, but are you looking at the regional rail services that have been considered under the commuter rail study, and how that impacts possible ridership, are we assuming that maybe the regional rail system is already up and running, and those improvements on that corridor have been already done and are not being those costs are not being double counted on the capital cost side, and are we including the service options on that corridor that could help maybe improve the ridership?
So I would say, answering the second point, the rail vision is what you're referring to. That was underway while we were doing our study, so we have not necessarily incorporated the regional rail network into our study. But we do have, we have covered our future no-build projects. So there are projects that obviously would benefit East-West Rail or regional rail that are underway, or they're in some level of planning or permitting. So there are overlapping projects that could be beneficial, and we're not necessarily tying those to East-West Rail. If that answers your question, Travis.
Yes.
Okay, great.
Thanks, Travis. Representative Sabadosa, should we unmute you?
Yes, thank you. I guess I'd just like to clarify then what is being asked of us in the next week. So while I'm very happy to eliminate bus service as an option out to Pittsfield, I do think it should be all rail. The conversation about hybrids is really interesting, and I would hate for us to say, well, we've picked these three things and we'd like you to do no further study on potential other options. So what exactly should we be conferring with you about, considering as we move forward, so that all of us have good marching orders?
Well, I have ideas, but Ethan, I'm going to let you answer that one.
Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Representative Sabadosa. So I think the idea is to, we've developed six preliminary alternatives. And for the most part, we want to use those six to narrow down to three, but that doesn't mean we would close the door on any other suggestions. We would have to obviously take them under consideration given the time remaining, the amount of the level of work and whether or not we feel at this point it's relevant to incorporate. Because again, there's going to be follow-up study through project development that something like variations could be looked at. So we definitely want to focus on our six, and a hybrid seemingly could come from a number of those. But again, other suggestions are welcome.
We're really just looking to get from the six to three. And I think, Ethan, if a brilliant hybrid comes out of one of those three, we're not precluding anything like that. And we were trying to get a sense of how everyone feels about the bus. Also, I guess if everyone feels if there was a strong sentiment to eliminate 1, 2, and 5, which are the bus options, does that mean that we are heading toward a consensus for 3, 4, and 6? So I'd be interested in any comments people might have briefly on that, so that we can then move to some public comment.
Right. Nancy, that's a great point. It would, if we could quickly eliminate the no bus alternatives, which it seems to be we hear a lot of feedback on that over time. It would allow the follow-up thought process from everyone, as well as comments coming into us, to be focused on a hybrid, if everyone feels 3 and 6 are ones we should carry forward.
Linda, see your hand up?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to comment a little further on if we're looking at hybrids let me ask a question first. Number 6 today shows Palmer is not being included, but alternative 6 back in February included it. So I was wondering if we could just clarify that.
Just looking at the deck, but my understanding is that Palmer is included in alternative 6.
Okay, great. So my concern was if we were looking at hybrids that could possibly include 5 and 6, now it doesn't include 6. If we're looking at a hybrid situation between 4 and 5, for instance, number 5 doesn't include Palmer, but it does, we would be looking at those speed and cost aspects. My concern about the reduced or the maintaining the 20-mile radius around a Palmer station is that it doesn't include the Amherst population, which is now being counted in Springfield. So it's being counted, and that's great. But if we're only looking at a 20-mile radius and we're not looking at that population that may be served out of Palmer, and we're also looking at a lesser rural area that could certainly have a significant over the years result of induced demand, I didn't want the Palmer station or an intermediate station to be easily dismissed if we're only looking at speed and cost. I want to make sure that we continue to concentrate on the other goals which an intermediate stop in Palmer would meet, and that is the social indicators of transportation and economic equity, health, air quality impacts from greenhouse gas emissions, housing and job competitiveness, and improved mobility for transit-dependent populations. I just want to make sure that we aren't going to then verge into a hybrid that is only going to concentrate on speed and cost, and therefore removing intermediate stop in Palmer and then dismissing all of these other really important aspects of serving the Western Mass region. Thank you.
So I think a reply to that, and thank you for that, is that one, in making your comments, you should say what you think the goals would be of any hybrid project so that we would understand clearly what's important in making a recommendation.
Well, my goal has always been to make sure that an intermediate stop in Palmer stays on those three alternates. So that to me is imperative.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ethan, did you want to add anything there? No? Go ahead.
No, I said no, I'm all set. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I don't see any other panelists' hands up. If that's the case, I'll give you another few seconds. I might go to the attendees for the public comment period. There we go. I would say that given that we've had a pretty strong expression of sentiment about eliminating 1, 2, and 5, it'll be really important in any comments and subsequent comments you share your thoughts about 3, 4, and 6. So if there's anyone at this point wants to say more about 3, 4, and 6, otherwise I will go to public comment. And probably start with a couple of questions because we do have some questions. Mayor Tom Bernard has said he'd like to echo what Rep. Pignatelli and Senator Hines are saying. Thank you, Mayor Bernard. Tim Newman, my name is Tim Newman. I am the chair of the Greater Barrington Economic Development Committee. He wants to make a statement about the impact of COVID-19, which completely changed the way urban residents think about city living, causing them to rethink their community. Afraid of contracting COVID. So he thinks the ridership estimates from before are totally irrelevant. We're going to fill up with new residents in Western Mass who want to stay connected to Boston and, I might add, to New York City. If you want Western Mass and the Berkshires to thrive, do the right thing. Okay. He asked where to make a further statement, and he should go to the website and send us a statement. From Ben Hood and Ann Miller, does the BCA include any infrastructure costs from Worcester to Boston? And if so, wouldn't that benefit riders in that area and affect the BCR? I can repeat that, Ethan, if you need me to.
So I turned to one of our project team. I could speak to it, but I don't want to misspeak, so.
The BCA, who's our BCA expert? Is that?
No, more the costing. Is that, would that be Ned?
Ned?
Yes. I'm sorry, Nancy, could you please repeat?
Sure, does the BCA include any infrastructure costs from Worcester to Boston? And if so, wouldn't that benefit riders in that area and affect the BCR?
There are a few improvements in the, For alternatives 1 through 5, there are some minor improvements in the Worcester to Boston section, sort of associated with facilitating connectivity to Worcester Station. But those are relatively minor costs, especially compared to the rest of the corridor. There are larger costs associated with alternative 6 because alternative 6 diverges from the rail right of way around the Mass Pike and Riverside to get into the I-90 corridor.
Thanks, Ned. Mr. Garrett asked, did the MassDOT consultants consider the impact of Valley Flyer and Hartford Line service on east-west ridership? It was not included initially and is not mentioned in Ethan's slides.
So the Valley Flyer is a pilot service, so we didn't include that, but we do include the Vermonter, and the Hartford Line service is included. Those are both considered transfer service, though, at Springfield.
Okay. I'm going to go to a couple of, if there are anyone, so here are the instructions for the raise a hand members of the public who'd like to share a question or comment verbally. And if you have any comments you would like to make verbally, you could raise your hand now. When I get to the right department, okay.
Yeah, and Nancy, we are running out of time. We're gonna have to run through these comments. So I would say that we'll obviously take the chat function and take those comments and any comments we receive online.
Right. Actually, I don't see any, so I think we're okay there. Please note that comments can be sent to Michaela, that her email is right here, and you can also reach her through the website. And we're asking everyone, the advisory committee members, to send us your thoughts on the three final alternatives by June 17th, a week from today. We will send you an email tomorrow reminding you of the schedule and how to send us a comment or your thoughts and questions as we go forward. Ned, Ethan, do you want to add anything before we wind up?
No. I just think, again, you know, as the secretary said, if we can hear the advisory committee's recommendations to us, their preferences, I should say, that I think we've heard loud and clear here that the no bus. So I think I feel like we have a consensus on the no bus. It's really to focus in on the hybrid. And we hope that we can get consensus via responses to Michaela via email. But if not, we will revisit our approach.
And I want to thank everyone for joining us today. We really appreciate your time. We look forward to hearing your comments and your final choices for the three final alternatives. We will be in touch again about the next advisory committee meeting and a public meeting. But in the meantime, please enjoy your summer safely. And we look forward to the next time we can be together again. So thank you very much.
Thank you.